y'all don't mind, let's go back to a time when we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, in spirit and in truth.
I love them old
church. That old brother, pick up that old hymn book and
singing,
you knew exactly what he was gonna say. Sisters got happy.
I love them old church.
Folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands, and all of a sudden, he break off in a song, something like this.
That is answering the challenge in First and Romans chapter 5 and verse number 20 through 21. But the Bible reads, moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound, but where sin abound, grace did much more abound. Let me say that again. Where sin abound, grace did much more abound. That as sin have reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through the righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
From this particular area, we find the teachings of the reformers who began to teach that because we have so much grace in Christ, that wherever sin is, grace would cover sin.
Mm-hmm.
And from that we have the illumination of man's mind, but not God's word, that somehow, as much as you sin, grace is going to somehow override the sin, and so I can sin and sin and sin, and grace will cover and cover and cover.
Mm.
This teaching is known as once saved, always saved. And in response to that, Paul says, well, what shall we say then? Shall we just keep right on sinning? That grace, is that in your Bible?
Mm-hmm.
Shall we continue to sin that grace may abound?
Uh-huh.
If Romans 5, 20 through 21 now becomes a launching pad, even those that are in the church, that you can just keep on living like you're living because the grace of God knows your heart. Paul says, well, shall we ever be obedient to God's word? Shall we continue to sin that grace shall abound? And then what does he say?
God
forbid.
Uh-huh.
How can we that are dead to sin live any longer therein?
Mm-hmm.
I want to talk to you this morning from the subject matter, dropping down to verse number 4. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism in his death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in a newness of life. I want to talk to you about walking in your resurrection. Because there's a difference in being baptized and being resurrected.
Amen.
If I would ask for a show of hands this morning, I'd find that there are a lot of Romans chapter 5 baptees in here who are living under the grace of God, but not giving God glory by the life that they live.
Uh-huh.
It is transference in that they can sit in the house of God and look like they mad at God, but don't want to give him glory. Whenever we live in grace without law, we live in lasciviousness and lostness. But when we understand the question, how can we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Something about your resurrection helps you to live by the glory of the Father.
Amen.
And so verse number 4 says that like as Christ, who died for sin but did not sin, had to trust in God to raise him up from the dead. You remember it was Christ that was on Calvary's cross. And it was Christ who was fighting in his flesh from the sixth to the ninth hour. Found he uttered those powerful words, into your hands I commend my spirit. The reason that many of us are not experiencing a resurrection is because we have not put ourselves in Christ's hand.
Uh-huh.
We have put ourselves into grace of the grace of God, which allowed us one more day, But we have not given ourselves wholly over to God. And when we give ourselves wholly over to God, the power of God will bring about a resurrection and a newness of life.
Man.
Make no doubt, make no mistake about it, that when you're baptized is the beginning process of a three-part reign of the death and the resurrection, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ.
Uh-huh.
Look at verse number 4 again, if you will. The Bible says, therefore we are buried with him. You came down the aisle one day, gave me your hand, and you said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. We buried you, we baptismed you, we buried you into the watery grave of baptism. And then you were in that water. We physically raised you up, but the resurrection process was still moving in your life.
Amen.
Now this is very important for you to get this point, because you're trying to figure, how did I get baptized and I'm still just like I was when I was baptized? Amen. I got it. How many of you were baptized and came up cussing just like you were before you got baptized? How many were baptized and came up still wrestling with stuff? Y'all about to tell the truth and stay in the church? How many of you were baptized and still came up sinning when you were baptized? Y'all about to say amen. How many of you are baptized and still don't know how to shout thank you Jesus every now and again? How many of you are baptized and still don't want to worship God? How many of you are baptized and still trying to figure sin out? How many have been baptized but there has been no resurrection in your life?
Man.
It's because it's a process in which the Holy Spirit takes over. And remember, God says in His Word in Acts chapter 2 and verse number 38, the Bible says that when we're baptized, we receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The gift of the Holy Spirit is not miraculous in nature for us. It's not speaking in tongues. It's not Mark 16:16 or 16:17. It's not picking up serpents. It's not some miraculous thing. But the gift of the Holy Spirit is that the Holy Spirit will begin to empower you where you didn't have power before.
Amen.
See, if you're still just like you were before you got baptized, you're still waiting on Easter.
Right.
Amen. Amen. You still waiting on some change in your life. You still waiting on a Passover. Death still has power in your life. Death will shut you up in church.
Amen.
Death will have you not talk to folk. Death will have you angry. Death will have you sad. Death will have you working for the devil. And when you're baptized and you've been through a resurrection, what used to have power over you don't have power over you any longer. Y'all like to say amen.
Amen.
Watch it, y'all. Back to the Bible. Watch it. Look at your Bible. Watch it. Now, if we read a little further, we'll find that Charles read in the scripture, knowing this, that what? Our old man, that all you was what? Crucified him, that what would happen?
The body of sin might be destroyed.
When Jesus was up on Calvary's cross, he was in the flesh. We know he was in the flesh. The Bible said he became flesh and he dwelt among us. But as long as he kept talking and looking around, said, Eli, lema sabachthani, he had not truly given himself over to the glory of the Father.
Uh-huh.
And when he trusted God, and that's something, when the Son has to trust God with his life, when he trusted God into your hands, I commend what?
My spirit.
Mm-hmm. How many of you give God glory by giving your spirit over to God?
Right.
How many of you tell your flesh that I'm giving this over to God?
Mm-hmm.
As long as you're wrestling with the Bible said that the body of sin might be destroyed. But the only way the body of sin is going to be destroyed is you have to learn to experience and desire the power and the working of the resurrection in your body.
Yeah.
I look at folks sometimes and I see they won't praise God. I say, you can't ask dead folk to praise God. Because when sin has power and dominion over you, you can't praise God like you want to.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. When sin has power and dominion over you, you know in your heart and mind, you're not right in the first place. You know you're living by grace. You don't appreciate grace. It's something about us and sin. Sin will have dominion and rule over you and run over you. And what sin will say to your body, you better not praise God. But this morning, I'm talking to three people that said, enough is enough. I'm about to give God glory in the mighty name of Jesus and praise God like God's done something for me. Amen. Anyhow. Amen. Now watch this. What is it that God does in verse number 4? God says, that I had to trust my Father. That's hard because I'm in the flesh and I make mistakes and I gotta trust God to raise me up.
Right.
Jesus had to trust in the Father to lift him up. Y'all seen that verse before? Read verse before. We read it in unison from right quick. What's the Bible say?
Therefore,
we're buried with him. We're buried with him by confessing Jesus Christ with our mouth, what we believe in our heart.
By baptism into death.
Have y'all heard that before? We're buried with him by having a unique experience. Mm. Is that in your Bible?
No.
Y'all let me teach you that, won't you? We're buried with him. Y'all act like this. Y'all sitting there looking like somebody think I'm telling the truth. We're buried with him. By a unique experience, while riding down the road, I saw a Bigfoot walking, and I stopped, and the Bigfoot would have got me, but God got the Bigfoot, and I said, I'm going to give God glory. We're buried with him because we've been emancipated from jail. I'm so tired of jailhouse salvation, I don't know what to do. You know, I'm glad you got out, but that don't necessarily mean that you have given yourself over to the Lord. And that's just because you got baptized. Don't mean that you've given yourself over to the Lord. Just because you come to church, don't mean that you've given yourself over to the Lord.
Man.
There's something about the resurrection that leaves us seeking God to take over in my life.
Right.
And every night you got to admit, Lord, if you don't take over and lift me up by the power of your resurrection, the dynamis of your gospel, the dynamite of your gospel. The Bible says in Romans 1, verse number 16, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ,
Amen.
But it's the power of salvation from the Jew and also to the Gentile. There's something about the gospel of Jesus that brings a quickening of the spirit. Am I right about it?
Amen.
That wakes me up in my dead state. That sin no longer has power in my life.
Amen.
And when you see a Christian walk around and say, I don't cuss like I used to cuss it. And I don't get mad like I used to get mad.
Right.
I don't do the stuff that I did. It's not because he did it. It's because the power of the resurrection of God gave
right.
him strength that sin no longer had power over his life. That's the problem for me as a preacher, because every now and then I get to looking at folk that's supposed to fit the script description. And I start trying to say, Lord, what is it? And I don't see them, amen.
Right.
When you walk around, folks that ain't been resurrected, been waiting on Easter to get resurrected, you walk around some mess. Am I right about it?
Uh-huh.
You walk around some zombie folk. They look like they walk around, but you can tell they're dead because they just stumble in the service whenever they get ready. And they sing if they want to, and they shout if they want to, and them old zombie folks sitting up there, and you gotta shoot them in the head with God's word, or they'll bite you and take your spirit away. Am I right about it? When you worship zombie Christians who have not experienced the power of the resurrection, they hate God so much, their main objective is to sit in here and look at you crazy if you shout amen. But I'm gonna tell that zombie real quick, I'm about to give God glory right up in your face, and you like it or not, I'm about to shout so loud, it's gonna disturb. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank God, all right. Isn't it all right? All right, now then, what preacher, I need some scripture. But first of all, this is what Paul says in the text. I'm going to take you to another verse. Maybe one other, and then I'm going to give this lesson to you. But you'll find that he says something about those who are living in the resurrection of Christ, that the old man is crucified, that the body of sin might be destroyed. Now watch, we should not do what? Serve sin. For he that is dead to sin. What does the Bible say from there? If you're dead from sin, he's what? If you're dead, if you've been resurrected, it don't mean you don't sin. It means that you've been
free from sin.
Lord have mercy.
Right.
Boy, that devil got some of y'all tongue. More, no. he must have told y'all don't say amen. Y'all need a resurrection. Y'all came to church, right? So y'all need a resurrection. Amen. There's some old dead Christians sitting up in here. Act like God ain't did nothing for them all week. Sit up here looking at me crazy like I ain't the enemy, but I'm going to preach the hell out of you every chance I get. Amen. I'm going to preach the hell out of you every chance I get. Amen. When you come here, you can expect a hell of a preaching every chance I get. Amen. I'm going to preach out because you need to learn to love God.
Man.
Give God everything you got. You shouldn't be able to sit down in the house of God and won't shout, thank you. Something wrong, amen.
Yeah,
there's
yeah.
something wrong with you. I know you didn't get here by yourself, am I right about it?
Yeah.
You didn't wake yourself up this morning, am I right about it? You're not walking around here, you know, if you know right. that you're not free from sin. You ought to have a desire for the resurrection to come in your life. And you ought to say, Lord, I need the power of your resurrection in my life because I'm still incarcerated in sin.
Amen. Amen.
He that is dead to sin is free from sin. And then this is what he says, drop down to the 13th verse. If I'm going to read it, drop down 13 verse. He says something else that's remarkable. That's powerful. I want you to understand this. Because here's the problem and why people leave the church is that when they got baptized, they thought they were free from sin. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they thought they were free from sin. They didn't really read the early verses that said that like as Christ, he was baptized, buried, and raised up by the glory of the Father. Let's go back up to verse 2. I want to show you something. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism. You got baptized. But now the raising up comes from God. How do you know? Because as Christ was buried, he raised up himself.
All
right. Y'all Bible say that?
No.
Y'all gonna make me mad in a minute. No. Do your Bible, why y'all let me say that then? I might as well be Baptist. Why y'all let me say that? That like as Christ raised up himself.
No.
When you got baptized, your lying mama and your sorry daddy told you somehow gonna raise up yourself. And they ain't raised up themselves. Or they won't let you live heathenistic in their house.
Right.
If you were in a resurrected house, when you got home, they'd raise you up. Mm-hmm. Now, baby, now that you're baptized, there's some things that have to change. Baby, now listen. You a child of God now. Oh, no, you can't wear that in front of me. I'm a woman of God. Oh, no, you can't talk like that in my, oh, no, but because there is no resurrection, there's just baptism, it's just more sin trying to be covered by grace. Okay. Y'all all right?
Mm-hmm.
What needs to happen is the power of the resurrection, not only to come, but the power of resurrection in your life right now.
Amen.
Now, if you dare to sin, what I just said bothers you a little bit. Because some of you go to hell for your mama. You know she's sinful. You know your daddy's sinful. You know you ain't nothing godly going on in your house. And yet you're willing to go straight to hell. Amen. Just defend them. How many of y'all go to hell for your mom and daddy right now? Raise your hand. Raise your hand. You see them at home sinning, lying and going on, double back biting, double dipping down on some sin. Uh-huh. Drinking gin and juice. Come y'all tell the truth. Uh-huh. Yeah, how many willing to go straight to hell for your mom and dad? The power of the resurrection insists that I take over the house. And I will resurrect that which is dead in the house. Psalms 127 and verse number 1. Except the Lord build the house. I don't care who your daddy and mama, I don't care if it's brother here. Except the Lord build the house. Mm-hmm. That's why you have crazy stuff in the house. That's why you can't keep expecting to have a sinful relationship and get godly results out of it. Uh-huh. You can't have an Ananias and Sapphira house where the husband and wife conspire not to give offering and think it's funny and think God gonna bless that house except the Lord build the house. You can't have a house where the woman running the house or the man ain't doing his job and thank God happy with that mess. That mess, that marriage is dead in sin. You can't keep sitting up supporting a man, letting him tell you that he's the head of the house, he won't even praise God, and you see his sinful self sitting around looking at other churches, doing whatever he want to do, and you sitting there looking, talking about, well, that's my husband. You're not going to get out. I'll cheat on you. You cheating on God, I hope you get three girlfriends. I hope she cheat on you with a basketball player. Amen. If you're going to live ungodly, hope the devil whoop you and whoop you good. Y'all say
amen.
You stop playing with God. Y'all going to make me mad. I'm trying to preach the short version. Y'all won't give God glory. I got to preach the hell out of it to somebody. Give him glory in the house of God.
Amen.
I've been doing this less than 15 minutes ago. Y'all just keep on wanting me to preach. So I keep right on preaching. I proved my point, but I got 35, 45, 50 minutes. Whatever y'all want, let me know. How many need 55 more minutes? Raise your hand. How many need 20 more minutes? Raise your hand. How many of you got 20 back here? We got 20. Can I get 25? Can I get 25? Amen. I got 25 of them. 25? Amen. Can I get 30? Amen. 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 All right. Are you getting what I'm saying? Dead to sin, the power of resurrection.
Amen.
The power of resurrection is to come to a place with God that you realize that you can't save yourself. Mm-hmm. And you acknowledge that even grace itself can't save you without faith.
Amen.
Ephesians writer says in Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 4, for we're saved by the grace of God through faith. Mm-hmm. There cannot be grace and no faith. There must be grace with faith. And the way God saves your house is that you realize that grace by itself has gotten you in trouble. Why shall we say then? Shall we continue sinning, counting on grace to save us? Grace didn't save them in Galatians 5 and 4. He says, I see that grace has become of no effect unto you. Seeing that you have fallen from grace. Amen. Let nobody tell you that grace will save you. What's going to save you, what's going to bless you, is when there's a resurrection in your life. Every now and again, you ought to tell the truth. Your wife will understand you better. Your husband will understand you better. Mm-hmm. Church will understand you better. You ought to tell them that I'm waiting on the power of the resurrection. Y'all say amen.
Amen.
I make mistakes every now and again, but rest assured I'm waiting on the power of the resurrection.
Amen.
Not only on the other side, but on this side right here. I'm waiting on the power of the resurrection. See, sometimes folk get to messing with me and getting me upset. I tell them I have not been resurrected yet. You probably better let me alone. Still have some dominion over me. If you keep on messing with me, thinking I'm somebody to play with, I'm going to take you around the corner. Amen. And we're going to both be waiting on the power. Y'all say amen. Amen. Of the resurrection and the resurrection. Oh, yeah, I can admit it that sin has a place, but God is in place.
Amen.
And I'm waiting on the power of his resurrection. Am I right about it?
Amen.
Paul was a great preacher. Am I right about it? It was Paul that wrote in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, that verse number 9. He said, I pray to God three times to help me in my sin. And then the Bible says that Jesus declared from heaven while Paul was waiting on the power of the resurrection. He said, I know you prayed three times, but my grace is sufficient for you, for when you're weak, then I'm strong. I'm right about it. It was Paul that declared in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 that our Paul was the chief of sinners. Guess what, Paul? He's waiting on the power of the resurrection. Am I right about it? It's Paul that's sitting down over in 1 Timothy chapter 4, where he says, I charge thee therefore before God, 2 Timothy chapter 4, and who should judge the quick and the dead, as appears, preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all long suffering. For the time will come when men will not endure sound doctrine after themselves, heap to themselves, teachers having itching ears. He said, but let me tell you something, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of your ministry, for the time of my departure is at hand. I'm sat for the defense of the gospel.
Amen.
The time of my offering, I'm ready to be poured out as a drink offering. I'm waiting for the resurrection.
Uh-huh.
Am I right about it? So all of you, if you don't understand what I'm saying, that there's something about the power of the resurrection that'll help you stop doing stuff that you just can't stop doing. That's why Paul declared it in the book of Philippians chapter 3 and verse number 10, all that I might know him and the power of his resurrection. Isn't it something to know God has brought you a mighty long way? The power of his resurrection. Places I used to go, I don't go no more. Stuff that used to upset me, don't upset me no more. People that used to deny me can't harm me anymore. Hard times can't depress me. Hungry days can't starve me. Lying tongues can't move me. Things I used to do, God has raised me up. And I want to keep lifting me up. Keep lifting me, Lord. Keep blessing me that I might know you in the power of your resurrection.
Amen.
If you want a real resurrection Sunday, tell the Lord that the resurrection begin in you. Now, some of you are sitting right now.
Amen.
And you know that there's some stuff you're doing you just can't stop doing.
Amen.
And what you've been doing, you've been saying, Lord, forgive me. And God said, I forgave you. But the problem is you still in bondage. I keep forgiving you, and you keep right on doing it. Because you think you can fix this thing by yourself. Sin has dominion in you, over you. Because if you die, keep on doing it. Whatever you're doing it is. How many of you got some doing this? You need some help with? Raise your hand. Tell the truth, Sancho. I've got two lying in here. Two of them lying. Okay, I've got one line. Okay. Okay, everybody tell the truth. Amen. We all say amen. We all got some doing it. Am I right about it? And it ought to be apparent to us that what our doing it is, we can't stop doing it. And so Paul says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue to live like this? Hoping that God will have mercy. He said, God forbid. Uh-huh. Know ye not, he that is dead to sin can live no longer therein? Mm-hmm. Therefore we are buried with Christ by baptism, the likeness of Christ is raised up by the glory of the Father. Mm-hmm. We need to start praying that, Lord, not only forgive me, but resurrect me for your glory. Y'all like saying that? That's the second word. Resurrect me for your glory. So folk can see if you lifted up a dirty, nasty person like me, that you showed up in hell. Some of you good old halfway clean Christians. Amen. 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 He can save you. He can show save you. That I may bring you glory in the power of your resurrection. You hear this morning? You're sitting here. You know you've been trying to do it. Got baptized, nothing changed. It shook your faith up. Matter of fact, you've seen other people get baptized, and they're still nasty, and that messed your faith up. You know what you need to be talking about? Lord, I need the glory and the power of your resurrection.
Amen.
Don't you fall for this Easter stuff. There should be a resurrection in your life right now. Mm-hmm. Jesus declared in the book of John 11, the Gospel of John, verse 26, I am the resurrection. He says in John 14, I am the way, the truth, and the life.
All right.
If you'll turn yourself over to God, he'll take that demonic spirit out of you. You won't sit up in church looking like you're ready to bite somebody because you've had some struggles not being able to do the devilment that you're used to doing. You won't sit up in church and won't give God glory. You won't sit up and watch somebody pass a collection plate and act like you didn't get paid. Y'all say amen. You sit up here and play praise like you ain't got no, like you didn't, God didn't bless you. Here comes the collection plate. You always want to check the watch during the collection time and start looking up in the air. You want to start looking at Jesus when the collection plate come by and it just happened to go by. You'll stop all that stuff.
Amen.
You'll give God glory.
Amen.
To him it belongs forever. Everything you have, everything you are is because of him.
Amen.
We wouldn't even be here if it wasn't him. And you can't hate nobody because he didn't hate you when you did the nasty stuff that you did. And the reason you're going to hell is because you will not experience your resurrection.
Amen.
I'm talking to folk who said, I've had enough of me. And I want more of him. You've heard the word today. You believe what you've heard. Repent of your sins. Confess him to be Lord in your life. Confess the sweetest name of mortal tongue. Put him on in baptism. You can leave here. Saying, now that I'm buried with him by baptism, I was raised up by the glory of the Father, that I should no more serve sin, but henceforth serve the Lord. This lesson is yours. As Anthony is saying, you got the stand and saying the song, heaven's waiting, and the song invitation, heaven's waiting mercifully when you come. You come right now.